Okay, so as I wrote in my mail, this would be, this lecture should be for a very specific purpose, which is basically to give you some basic ideas so that you can start reading the perhaps paper on this subject. And then there is also an earlier paper which deals with similar issues but not quite the same. So the main idea here is to try to classify systems with gaps, okay, with gaps in the spectrum. And we will begin by working with the field Feldman Hamiltonian. Feldman system, the zero dimensional Feldmans, where the Hamiltonian I'll write as sum over j k x dk dk dagger dk and the a is satisfied the usual anti commutation relation, so aj dk dagger dk and AJAP. Okay, these are some numbers. XJK is a number, but we want the Hamiltonian transition, okay, which basically requires that XJK star should be equal to XJK. Which basically means that x would be a Hermitian matrix. So in this case we can write x as u x d u dagger, where u is unitary, u dagger is identity, x d is diagonal, lambda 1 to lambda n, which is an n by n matrix. And in terms of this, the Hamiltonian can be written as sum over g and k and this I can write, rewrite sum over n. I should just write the sum over m n, that b n is sum over k. Okay, so basically I redefine u k n star a k as my b n. Similarly, U G M A J dagger will be B M dagger, and because X D is diagonal, okay, it's just lambda n times L times, and so on. So substitute this, you get the diagonal. Is this clear? So from this one can work out the down step. So the ground state will be satisfying that Bm on omega is equal to 0 for lambda n positive, and Bm dagger on omega should be 0 for lambda n negative. In other words, you have to basically kill all the negative energy states to get the ground state. And such a state will be the lowest energy state. And we'll assume that no lambda vanishes. This in fact will be one of the central points. In this case, the down state is non-degenerate. Down state is unique. Or we say that the spectrum is gapped. Okay, that there is a finite difference between the ground state and the far state excited state. If some of the lambda n's been 0, okay, then for those lambda n's, you could define the vacuum either by using this or by using this. But what will happen is that if you apply, suppose you have defined a vacuum applied using this, then Bm dagger on omega will have exactly the same energy, because the corresponding lambda vanishes. And the ground state will be non-infinite. So you can either declare omega as your ground state or Bm dagger omega as your ground state. If you use Bm dagger omega as your ground state, that new ground state will not satisfy this condition rather than this one. Okay. So this is important. Okay, because we will be classifying Hamiltonians, satisfy this, that the ground state is unique, the spectrum is gap, and this is where the notion of insulators and superconductors start. Okay, so this is supposed to be topological classification of insulators or superconductors, and these, of course, as you know, are systems where there is gap, the finite energy difference between the ground state and the far state. We will try to make this problem a little more specific by saying that lambda m lies in a bounded domain. Namely, we assume that mod lambda m lies between some two numbers alpha and alpha inverse for some alpha. And I'll take the lower and upper one to be as alpha and alpha inverse. Okay, of course, then it not any lambda m satisfy any of the bounds.
Sir, can you again explain that lambda m greater than 0 that
actually? Oh, because the Hamiltonian is this. Right? So we want that omega has to be downstate, right? So if we take this Hamiltonian and act on omega, okay, if omega satisfies these two conditions, then you can check that any other state that you can get. See, if omega is defined this way, then the excited states are either of the form Bm dagger on omega. This is for lambda n positive, or Bn on omega for lambda n negative. Okay? Because Bn annihilates omega for lambda n positive. So you can apply Bn, you cannot apply Bn, but you can apply Bn dagger. And similarly, Bn dagger annihilates omega for lambda n less than 0. Okay? So you cannot apply Bn dagger, you can apply Bn. And now, if we apply the Hamiltonian on this, then you will find that H on Bn dagger of omega is lambda n Bn dagger of omega. plus the entire on each of them. That's why what kind of computation relation between H and the entire. So effectively what is going to happen is that when H applies or acts on the entire omega, it picks up the eigenvalue that we already had for omega. But it adds to it lambda n. And if lambda n is positive, then you can see that this part adds to the ground state energy. So it's at its depth, right? It's above the ground state energy. On the other hand, for these kinds of BNs, okay, you can apply the same game, H on BN omega. You will find minus lambda n BN omega. But for those lambda n is negative, that's again you will find that it's actually raising the energy. Is this clear? So you can also think of it in terms of the filling the vacuum, right? Now if there is a, there are many energy levels, right? And if this is at your zero of energy, this is T equal to, this is lambda equal to zero, right? There is nothing at lambda equal to zero. So you can say that the, you start the state which is aligned by all the beings, okay, which is something like that. But now, that's not the lowest energy state, because if you can start filling these states, you lower the energy. Right? Because these states are negative energy. Right? From that perspective. So the ground state will be the one where you have filled all the states up to this. And the fact that you have to fill all the states up to this is encoded in the second condition, that these must have the negative energy states filled. Right? And hence it's a BN diagram which should annihilate them and not BN. So, any other questions?
One question.
Yes.
So, the spectrum is gapped in the sense that with the positive and the negative eigenvalues, they are separated. I mean, there is a discontinuity between them. But suppose I take.
Yeah, but that's only if you are thinking in terms of xd. Okay. If you think in terms of h, right, spectrum is gapped in the sense that there is a ground state. Right. This state is the lowest energy state. Omega defined this way. We are lowest energy state. Any other state that you have in the theory, which is obtained by other BM dagger for positive lambda or BM for negative lambda, those will have strictly more energy than omega. Okay? So this is the spectrum is gap. Right? Spectrum of X will be gapped in the sense of there are some positive energy, some negative energy state. But that's not the case for H. For H, there's the lowest energy state and everything else has strictly positive energy. Okay? So it's in that sense the spectrum is gap. Is this clear? So you should distinguish between the spectrum of X, which has both negative and positive energy state, and the spectrum of H, which has the lowest energy state, and then everything else is positive. Okay, because effectively, because you are filling up all the negative energy states. Now suppose you have another Hamiltonian, which is a, which has a form sum for JK, YJK. Again, Y is formation. And we also assume that the eigenvalues of y are going to satisfy the same form. So y is u or some other matrix v y diagonal v dagger. So y diagonal is tau 1, tau 2, tau n. And we assume that tau n lies with mod tau n lies with tau 1. So these then by the same construction will give you another system of the gap spectrum. Now the question that we'll be interested in is it possible to continuously deform x to y? So, and this is what one means by topological classification. Is it possible to continuously deform x to y? And in this deformation, you have to use, you want to deform via matrices which have gaps. Hermitian matrices. Okay, so exactly the same condition, Hermitian matrices. F, J, K. These gaps are. Exactly. You can always find some alpha which is off. As long as lambda is not reaching 0, right? We can always find alpha which satisfies this bound, right? So each lambda we are assuming is bounded, right? Both from above and below. Right? It cannot go to 0, it cannot go to infinity. So you can always find that alpha. Right? So that's why I will assume that you have small fixed system alpha and all eigenvalues always rely on that energy. Okay, the final result will be independent of alpha, so it doesn't matter. You can take alpha to be very small, which spans most of the real axis, positive real axis. So let me write this question more specifically here. Yeah? So is there, precise question that you want to ask, is there a matrix or family of matrices, let me write it, family of matrices P such that for P, for P running through such that for f, j, k, p equal to 0 is the matrix x, f, j, k, and p equal to 1 is the matrix y, or eigenvalues f, j, k. And the fourth condition is that FJK should be a smooth function. It shouldn't just jump. P is a continuous function.
You need only continuous or do you need smooth as well?
No, we just want continuous. Okay? So if such a function exists, then that means that we can deform x to y. Okay, because you can continuously change from x to y via this family of matrices. Okay, which at one end is x, at the other end is y, and the change is continuous.
Sir,
yes.
How do we know that this deformation trajectory in this function is single parameter only, like you parameterize it by t, right?
Yes.
So, like primarily, how do we judge that whether it will be just minimally single parameter transformation?
Well, you don't gain very much by introducing multiple parameter because you want to change x to y continuously, right? Okay. Okay. So that means that whether there is an intermediate set of matrices that you can find, so that at each stage the change is small. Right? You change x to x prime to x double prime to x triple prime till you reach y. Okay. So that you can always label by one single parameter. Right? You can try to look for multi-parameter space, but it doesn't gain you much, right? I mean, because you want to simply deform from x to y. Right? And every stage you just change, right? X to x prime to x double prime, each change is small. So you just put those matrices together and you will get a continuous part. So if it is possible to change x to y continuously, you will find a part like this.
It's a trajectory in the matrix space, right?
Exactly. It's a trajectory in the matrix space. Right? If there is such a trajectory in the matrix space, then you will see that there is a continuous way you can change it from x to y. You can think of, try to construct functions of two variables, but it will not tell anything about the continuity. Anything more than what the one variable thing tells us. Any other questions? Now, why is this question interesting? I think there are probably various reasons. Okay, let me just tell you one. So let's suppose that this x and y, these two Hamiltonians, they represent some two different systems, okay, which you continuously connect. Okay, so imagine that we have the part here, the system is described the matrix X, so the habit corresponding Hamiltonian is the X, J, K, A, J, dagger, A, K. Here the matrix is the Y, Y. Okay. And in between, the Hamiltonian changes smoothly to go from X to N. Okay. Suppose there is such system. Now, if X and Y do not belong to the same topological class, which means that if there is no way that you can deform X to Y continuously, satisfy these conditions. That would mean that somewhere in between, the spectrum is gapless. Right? Because you cannot go from x to y through gap spectrum, okay, if x and y are in different topological classes. So by finding the topological classes of matrices as defined here, okay, two matrices are topologically the same, if they can be continuously deformed to each other by matrices of this type. So if we have two matrices which are not topologically the same, then we can say that at the interface, okay, where the Hamiltonian continuously change from whatever it was here to whatever it is there, there must be a region where there is gapless. Okay, so knowing the topological classes of the system at the two ends, you can figure out whether there will be a gapless mode somewhere in between. So this is one possible application of this kind of study. Classify the matrices or Hamiltonians using topological matrices.
So this choice of alpha is arbitrary?
It's arbitrary. Right? But it is not zero. Because we want to have gapless. Okay, otherwise it's arbitrary. So this is the topological question you have to ask. We want to find out different topological classes according to this classification. But in this case, of course, the problem is very simple. So you could just solve it without going through any of what I'm going to describe now. Okay. But we'll try to make this a more sophisticated problem. Okay, the more sophisticated sounding problem, because we can use the language. Okay, for later cases where direct analysis will also.
This assumes that in the space of all Hermitian matrices, there
yes.
is a path that connects them.
Exactly.
That is there is no subtlety in there. I mean, that's guaranteed.
Yes, so Hamiltonian is Hermitian. There is a Hamiltonian which connects x to y. Okay? And the point is that if the Hamiltonian goes from x to y, then if x and y are different topological classes, so we know that the Hamiltonians will have a gap. does it have gap less? Yeah, because if you could go from x to y via Hamilton with gaps, right, then they would have been in the same problem. Okay, now.
So why do we need this eigenvalues of fjkt between alpha and alpha minus 1 for the intermediate states?
Well, that's the definition. Because as people have been emphasizing, alpha is really arbitrary, right? Yes. All this is saying is that you don't want the eigenvalues to be allowed to be 0. Right? You want to avoid 0 eigenvalues. Right? So you pick some small number alpha, and you only want to bend this switch whose eigenvalues lie between alpha and alpha. So this is basically most of the Malaysian alpha.
Sir, but I want to the my eigenvalues between alpha and alpha inverse.
Yes.
For the endpoints only. Not for the intermediate
states. No, the point is that if in the intermediate states you allow fjk to have 0 eigenvalues.
No, not 0, some other eigenvalues.
Yes. So the point is, you allow anything that you like, as long as alpha is sufficiently small, those eigenvalues lie in alpha. So because you are not saying anything about alpha, right? Alpha can be arbitrarily small. Yeah? You are not losing anything by putting this restriction. That if we find that you can go between x and y by making the eigenvalue very small, you just change your definition of alpha. Yeah? And then it will follow, satisfy this. So alpha in this substance is the lowest possible eigenvalue that you may ever need for it. Right? And all you hear is that sort of thing.
Like we are for the codifying our information, that I am deforming continuously.
Yes.
With the fourth condition. Yes. I am saying that the transformation has to be
continuous. Yes.
That's how we are codifying that information.
Exactly.
So how you are sir, saying that for gap spectrum this other condition, where that information is going into it is valid for only for gap spectrums, not for others.
See, this is my definition. That I want to see. If two Hamiltonians, given two Hamiltonians, right, I'll say that they are in the same topological class. If we can go from one to the other, okay, via Hamiltonians, which are all gapped, okay, and continuous.
Okay.
All have eigenvalues between alpha and alpha minus. All have eigenvalues alpha and alpha inverse, right, or all have non-zero eigenvalues, right? That's good enough. Okay. Then we can always find an alpha so that all have eigenvalues between alpha and alpha inverse. Okay. If we find a interpolating part which actually goes to a 0 eigenvalue. Right? That is not good enough for us to classify that they are in the same topological class. Right? Because that's not a very useful information. Okay? In fact, almost all Hermitian matrices can be continuously deformed from one to the other. Okay? If we don't put decisive restriction.
Sir, so when we are saying that we are deforming our Hamiltonian from x to y.
Yes.
By some parameter. So what actually it means that physically we have some Hamiltonian. So
yes, you said change the domain, right? You have some x and y, suppose x and y depends on how you have built the system, right? You change the doping continuously to go from x to y. Okay, that will be one possible deformation. Now there are various kinds of ways you can have deform Hamiltonian. Right? Or put some magnetic field or whatever.
And sir, we are defining our spectrum, gap yes. Spectrum, for any gap, any non-zero gap.
So
that can be different from.
Exactly. So the point is, I put alpha to be the lowest possible thing that I want. Okay. Say 10 to the minus 5, right? Okay, and I let the lambda lie between 10 to the minus 5 and 10 to the plus 5.
Yes, sir. Then there are only two classes. One is gap spectrums.
Yes.
Any gap that is non zero. And another is gap is equal to 0.
No. We will see that there are more classes. The Hamiltonian, right? We are only classifying gap Hamiltonian, right? Endpoints are always gap.
Yes, sir.
But then, not all Hamiltonians with gap endpoint spectrum can be deformed each other. Right? They will be different of classes. Okay, that's what we will see. Okay, for example, a matrix with eigenvalue 1, 1 and a matrix with eigenvalue minus 1, minus 1. Okay, so these will be different
numbers. So if matrices are finite dimensional, then if x and y have same number of positive and negative eigenvalues, then they can always be different.
Yes, in this case. Okay, but this will not be the case other on all of this. Okay. because in this case, that's what I said, that you don't need to know any sophisticated mathematics to solve this problem. That as long as we have the same number of positive and negative eigenvalues, you can deform one to the other. But we'll develop this language which can be useful, okay, for tackling more general problems, right, where things may be a little more complicated. Okay, so now we are going to make things a little more specific. Okay. So given x, the width can be soft and always be written as uxd. Where xd was lambda 1, lambda 2. We define x tilde, which is u lambda 1 over mod lambda 1. And this is possible because none of the lambda n signs, right? So you can always divide by the mod of this. So what this is doing is that it is basically replacing all the eigenvalues by plus or minus 1. If it's replaced by plus 1, if the eigenvalue was positive, if it's replacing the minus 1, the eigenvalue was negative. Okay, so x still doesn't do that. So similarly, we do this for y.
Y tilde is p and is tau 1, tau 1.
Okay. So x tilde and y tilde.
X tilde. Y tilde are conditional matrices.
X tilde is deformable
to y tilde
if
there is a continuous family of Hermitian matrices.
And we note this by saying that x tilde is topological equivalent to y tilde. So now you see that we are putting a more restrictive condition on what we mean by saying that x tilde is deformable to y tilde. Okay. X tilde has eigenvalue plus minus 1, y tilde has eigenvalue plus minus 1. And now we are saying that we will say that x tilde is deformable to y tilde only if they can be deformed via a continuous family of Hermitian matrices with eigenvalues plus minus 1. Okay. So this is a stronger condition that we are imposing than what we had before between x and y. Okay. Because you can deform from x to y, there you allow a deformation from x to y by going to any set of matrices whose eigenvalues are not zero. two variables like alpha and alpha inverse. Now you are putting a more restrictive condition on what you mean by information.
If x and y were interpolated, like if one can interpolate between x and y, doesn't this follow from that? Or?
Yes, so that's what we will now show. That this problem, even though you are putting a restrictive condition, this condition is equivalent to the ordinary one. Because, as stated, you are not allowing interpolation via matrices of eigenvalues which are not equal to class matrices. Right? I mean, it could have happened that you can interpolate between x tilde and y tilde via matrices which have eigenvalues not necessarily equal to class matrices. Right? But you cannot do it via matrices with eigenvalues class matrices. Right? So, it could have happened, right? But we will see that it will not happen. Because in this sense, that this is at least as stated, it's more restrictive, right? Because you are putting stronger restriction on what kind of matrices you now have to interpolate with next. Is this clear? Okay. So now the claim is that if x is deformable to y, then x tilde is deformable to y tilde. So let me write it. The deformable here has a stronger notion, so let me make this one for spin, then x tilde is y tilde and vice versa. Namely that if x was deformable to y, via matrices with eigenvalues who are lying between alpha and alpha inverse, then x tilde is deformable to y tilde via matrices with eigenvalues like eigenvalues are just plus minus 1. And the reverse is also true. Okay, if x tilde can be deformed to y tilde via matrices with eigenvalues plus minus 1, then x can be deformed to y. Then the proof actually is quite simple. So let's first prove the reverse. Now suppose x tilde is deformable to y. Okay, by matrix of y equal plus minus 1. Okay, then you want to prove that x is deformable to y. Okay, you have to find a path that takes x to y. Okay, but via matrices which are always gap, which are always gap, right? So what you do is that you can first go from x to x tilde. X to x tilde can be the always gap, right? Because if you let me just say this. How do you do this? You change lambda I to lambda I over 1 minus p plus p mod lambda. So this function at t equal to 0 gives the eigenvalue lambda I. And at t equal to 0 these things all vanish. You get the lambda I. At t equal to 1, you get lambda I over mod lambda I. So this interpolation, this you just skip the matrices as u times that function of t here, lambda u lambda. At t equal to 0, it will give you back the matrix x. At t equal to 1, it will give you back the matrix x. Then, we go from x tilde to y tilde. This by definition exists, right? Because x tilde and y tilde have been assumed to be equivalent. Right? So you can always change from x tilde to y tilde. This is done by matrices of eigenvalue plus minus 1. But those are of course special cases of matrices whose eigenvalues are equal to alpha and minus 1. Okay? So this is possible, and then you go back from y tilde to y. And this is done by changing. Well, I'll leave it as an x test to find out what kind of function interpolates this. So you have to do the reverse, right? Just change t to 1 minus t.
tau I over P plus 1 minus T times tau I. Okay.
So that P equal to 0, you get tau I over dot tau I, that's the matrix Y I, Y tilde, and then at P equal to 1, you get back tau I itself, because this goes to 0, so you get the matrix Y. Okay, so this path, if this gives it, provides a continuous path that connects X to Y. Let's now put the reverse. So what is the reverse? Suppose there is f jk of t that interpolates. And then you have to prove that then x tilde and y tilde are equivalent. Okay, that there is some interpolating function. Okay, interpolating set of matrices that takes from x tilde to y tilde. But those interpolating matrices must have eigenvalues plus minus 1. Okay? So you cannot use the original fjk of t to do the job. Okay? The fjk of t doesn't have eigenvalues plus minus 1. Okay? So let's see what this means. So you can write fjk of t as some w of t. F1, F2 of T is the diagonal form. W of T inverse. Okay, this you can always do because FJK by definition is a Hermitian matrix. Okay, so a Hermitian matrix can always be diagonalized. Okay, so W is unitary. And of course you know that W0 is U, W1 is V. And if j 0 is lambda, if j 1 is tau. Okay, because if j cap t equal to 0 must reduce to the matrix X, and if j cap t equal to 1 must reduce to the matrix Y. So then consider the following matrix F tilde jk of T, W of T, I call this inverse, but inverse is the same as diagonal. These have been using diagonal earlier. So since this fi of t, these are continuous functions, and these don't vanish. Right? None of the fi's vanish. Okay, that was the condition, right? That fjk should cannot have zero eigenvalues. So this is a well-defined option. This matrix is well-defined, w is continuous. So this has a property that f tilde jk of 0 is x tilde jk. That's why definition of x tilde, because x tilde was after all lambda 1 over mod lambda 1, lambda 2 over mod lambda 2. These are the eigenvalues. F tilde jk of 1 is y tilde jk. And F tilde has eigenvalues plus minus 1. That is by construction. Right? right? Because r gets divided out by the mods. So you have killed as an interpolated function. Okay, interpolated function. So you have killed off the interpolated function x at that point.
W of t is unlike that u u diagram which we have used.
Yes, exactly. These are unitary, but these W of t have to be found for f j k of t separately. F j k of t is Hermitian, so W of t is a diagonalizing matrix. Right? Whatever matrix diagonalizes f j k of t is what I am calling. Okay, so this is actually f of t. I shouldn't write the index. Okay, j k are the matrices. So these are matrices. So f is this. Yes, so W of course is different. W of 0 is 0 and W of 1 is 0. So it's very, so the higher values are plus minus 1, right? But W is changing. So this means the following. The conclusion. Is that for finding the topological classes of H, it is enough. The topological equivalent matrices of higher values plus minus 1. Okay, in this set, the two matrices will be considered equivalent. They can be deformed from one to the other via matrices of higher values plus minus 1. That is enough to classify the original Hamiltonian problem, right? Where you didn't have eigenvalues as equal to plus minus 1. Okay, because what we saw is that the two problems are exactly equivalent, right? X is deformable to y, then x tilde is deformable to y tilde, and vice versa. So you might as well work with x tilde and y tilde. Which are eigenvalues plus minus.
But wouldn't it be that there we'll have more option to explore than here?
But that's what this shows, that you don't have more option. Right? What this is saying is that the number of topological classes that you have by restricting to I matrix of eigenvalue plus minus 1 is exactly the same as the number of topological classes that you have by without putting that restriction. Right? Because all you have to do to find if x and y are topological equivalent is that you just collapse them to eigenvalues of matrices of matrices of eigenvalue plus minus 1 by using the procedure that I described. First diagonalize and then each eigenvalue you replace by plus 1 or minus 1 depending on whether it's positive or negative. Okay. And then what this is saying is that if the corresponding x tilde and y tilde are deformable by matrices of eigenvalues plus minus 1, then x and y are deformable by matrices of eigenvalue of non-zero eigenvalues. And vice versa. If x and y are deformable by matrices of non-zero eigenvalues, then x tilde and y tilde are deformable by matrices of eigenvalues plus minus 1. So that's the reason why you don't have any more option. Right? It will give exactly the same topological classification.
Oh, I meant more matrices, more paths. I mean, there are more paths in the other scenario. Because
but what this analysis shows is that those paths are not, you cannot really change the result. Right? Of course, there are more paths in the other scenario, right? Because you are arriving paths which do not respect the eigenvalue equal to 1 function, right? Eigenvalue equal to plus minus 1. But having those paths is no use in connecting x and y if the corresponding x tilde and y tilde are not connected already.
Yeah. Right? And also, can one say that because here we are restricting, because the choice itself is, we have shortened the choice of matrices
and the choice of paths.
Yes.
Exactly. You have shortened the choice of matrices and the choice of paths. In general, it might have changed the result. Right? It could have been that if x tilde and y tilde are not deformable, but x and y are deformable because there are more paths.
Yes.
Right? But what this is saying, this analysis showed, These are dash dot methods.
Yes.
Right? That if x tilde and y tilde are deformable, then so is x and y, and vice versa. If x and y are deformable to each other, so are x tilde and y. Okay, so that's the reason why the classification is exactly the same. Okay? So you might as well restrict to matrices for eigenvalues plus minus 1. Is this point clear? Okay, so then we now focus on this problem that we want to focus on classifying Hermitian matrices of eigenvalues plus minus 1. And by classifying, we mean that we want to classify equivalent, topologically equivalent classes which cannot be deformed to each other via matrices of eigenvalues plus minus 1. So this classification problem actually is quite simple. Okay, well, let me go through the formal analysis later. So if x tilde is a matrix of eigenvalue plus minus 1, then we can always write x tilde as u times a bunch of ones, bunch of minus ones. And notice that I have added the eigenvalues so that it's all plus 1 initially and all minus 1. Okay, so typically, there will be a certain number, say k minus 1 eigenvalues and n minus k plus 1. Okay. And u is an n by n unitary matrix. So u also belongs to un. Okay, un is a group of n by n. So this is saying that for every u of this kind, we have an x, and vice versa. For every x, we have u. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the number of possible x's is the same as the number of possible u's. Okay? And the reason is that not all u's may give the same, not all u's may give different x's. Okay? That there will be more than one u which gives the same x tilde. Okay? So then those u's are not, has to be treated as equivalent. Right? So the, in other words, if you want to see what is the space of possible x tildes, Hermitian matrix of eigenvalue plus minus 1. That space is not necessarily un, okay? Because un is the space of matrices u, but not all of these can give generated equivalent x tilde.
If these numbers k is fixed for a system,
no, k is not fixed for a system in general. Okay? Therefore, that's what will come in topological classifications. Okay? Because all I have said so far is that we are looking at matrices eigenvalues plus minus 1. I have not told you how many plus eigenvalues, how many minus. It's not fixed. For the whole class, it's not fixed. Okay, so now it's easy to see that if we take a matrix, if we replace u by u times the matrix VW, where V is n by n unitary,
n minus k by n minus k.
And W is A by K, right? Then let's see what happens to X tilde. So X tilde will go to, so U will be replaced by this matrix, right? U is the n by n matrix, arbitrary n by n arbitrary matrix, and then V and W, this is a block diagonal form, we have zero. V is a n minus k by n minus k dimension arbitrary matrix, W is k by k. So x tilde will go to U, a, U times V, W, then 1, 1, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 6, 1, V diagram, W diagram, and E diagram. Now we can calculate this part of the product explicitly, okay, because it's VW, block diagonal form, this is just identity matrix, okay? N minus K by N minus K identity matrix is K by K identity matrix, okay? So this you can write as U times V, V dagger, W, W dagger, minus W, W dagger. If this scale, because identity minus I, right? That's the structure. So let me write it. So V, W, identity minus identity, right? It's a different dimension. So let me write, put the labels, V, A minus K, W, K. Just says that it's N minus K by N minus K matrix, K by K matrix. I, N minus K, minus I. And then V, N minus K dagger, W, K dagger. So this will give you V, N minus K, V n minus k dagger and minus W n minus k. W n minus k dagger. That's my matrix product. So this is identity n minus k minus identity k. So okay, so this gives you. So you can easily check that this gives you back its tilde. Yeah, because this matrix, okay, is the same as what? As this matrix.
So you do x tilde equal to, so that,
yes, x tilde. I wrote u times v dot u, right? Because I have changed u to u times v dot u, right? And I want to see how x tilde changes. Okay. So in the expression for x tilde, wherever there is u, I wrote it u times vw, okay. And for u dagger I wrote v dagger w dagger times u dagger, okay, because the matrix order gets changed from the condition form, okay. And now I am calculating this part first, okay. So the first n minus k by n minus k block gives you v times v dagger, okay, that's what I have written, v times v dagger, and then the k by k block which appears here gives you minus w n minus k dagger. But now I use the fact that V I have taken to be unitary. Okay, so V V dagger is just identity. W I have taken to be unitary, so W W dagger is just identity. So this is back to I minus I. Okay, that is the same matrix that was here.
So this we are going to remove those redundant extra.
Exactly. So you are trying to see that not all U's give inequivalent x-tildes. Okay, that some of the U's, which the U's may be different, but the x-tildes will be the same, right? And that's what you are saying here, that even when you replace u by u times v w, the x tilde that I will get is the same.
W k,
yeah, fine, W k.
We could have taken V and W to be general matrices and then at the end demanded that this give me back the same X and derive that they have to be unitary.
That is true. But if you take V and W to be the same general matrices, then this will not be unitary.
Right.
Okay. Because I want U to be unitary, right? So to multiply by something and get a unitary matrix, I have to demand from the beginning itself the V and W. And one can show that this, in fact, is the only ambiguity that you have. Okay? Once you have removed this kind of ambiguity, that multiplying u by a matrix of this kind from the right, then defined views really give defined axes. Defined axes. Ambiguity. Well, basically you have to demand that you make some change in u prime times this times u prime dagger, right? Is the same as u times this times u dagger. Okay, and you have to just massage the relation a little bit and you'll find that the u and u prime, the most general relation between u and u prime that we can have is on this form.
But importing the transform, u must also be unitary. That's the concept.
Yes, that's right. You are always looking for u which is unitary, right? So among the unitary u's, right, you are asking that if u and u prime both give the same x delta, right? That means u times this times u dagger gives you x delta, u prime times this times u prime dagger gives the same x delta. That relates u and u prime, right? That gives a relation between u and u, right? And then you impose a condition that u is unitary, right? And you will find that the only most general solution for u prime will be of this. Okay, this requires some effort, but it's kind of good.
Sir, you didn't prove that equation.
I didn't prove?
First equation, x tilde is equal to u. Whether this kind of transformation are possible or not. Writing x tilde in that form, u.
Because x tilde is a Hermitian matrix,
yes.
Right? Whose eigenvalues are plus minus 1. Right? So this is always possible, right? Because in a Hermitian matrix can be diagonalized by unitary matrix. Yes.
But how could you collect this?
That's because you can, if the ones and minus ones are in different places, right, you could exchange them by unitary transformation. Right? For example, 1 minus 1 and minus 1 1 right, are related by the unitary transformation by 0 1 1 0. Right? That's the exchange operation. So you can always find the product of unitary transformations, right, which bring back from any order to this order. Look at this again, you can verify very easily, right? You start with a different ordering between 1s and minus 1s, and you will find that there are exchange operations, right? Which are basically off diagonal matrices, with 1 and entry 1 on the off diagonal and 0 on the diagonal, right? Which will do it. Okay, so this basically tells us that the space of x tilde. Is u n minus k un quotiented by u n minus k times u k. And then you have to take the sum of these spaces because you have not begin with say what this k is. K could be 0, 1, 2, anything up to n. So if the matrices have k negative and n minus k positive eigenvalue, right, then this is the space of x tilde. Okay? It's the space of unitary n by n matrices. Okay? But it's actually quotient because you have to mod out by u n minus k times u k. Because multiplying u the n by n matrix, unitary matrix, by this doesn't change x tilde. Okay? So this is the space for the x tilde with this structure. N minus k positive and n k negative values, and then you have to sum over k from 0 to n to find the whole space. Is this clear? And now the topological classification problem. This reduces to the following question. So given x tilde and y tilde, there are two points on this space. Okay? And the question that you want to ask is there a continuous path? Yes.
x tilde.
Then if there is a contiguous path connecting x tilde and y tilde in this case, that means that x tilde can be contiguously deformed to y tilde via matrices of this side. Okay? Because all points in this space represent some matrix of this side.
So our job is to find that f which can transform this x tilde to y tilde.
We don't have to find a path, we just have to find the classes of points which are any given, right, which cannot be connected. Okay, you want to classify topological equivalent points, right? Okay, which means that two points will be topological equivalent if there is a path that connects them. They are topological non-equivalent if there is no path connected. Okay, and now we can use a well-known mathematical result that the group UN is connected. Okay, which means that given any two points in UN, there is a continuous path in UN that goes from one to the other. Okay, so if UN is connected, because we are modified by a connected group, this OSET is also connected. Which means that if we put to pick two points, x tilde and y tilde, and if they happen to be on the same component, see this space has many components, right? N different components. So if x tilde and y tilde happen to be on the same component, then you can find a path that connects them. If x tilde and y tilde are on different components, then there is no path connecting them, right? Because it's like you have a sphere here and you have a sphere here, right? Or a torus here, right? Two different spaces. And then in general, if you put a point here and a point here, right? There is a continuous path on the manifold that connects the points, because they are two disjoint spaces. Okay, so this basically gives us back the answer that we got to guess from the beginning. Okay? Namely that if two matrices have the equal number of negative eigenvalues, then they should be deformed over to each other. Okay? Because if two matrices have the same number of negative eigenvalues, then they are in the same component, they are for the same value of E. And that space is connected. Okay, so you can always go from one to the other. Okay, if you have different number of eigenvalues, then the space is not connected. Okay, then we are in top of the equivalent classes. Okay, so this is saying that in this case there are n different topological equivalent classes. Okay, labeled by k running from 0 to n. Okay, again, this is something you could have easily guessed from the beginning. Because two Hermitian matrices, so that one is continuously deformable to the other, okay, is determined by that they have the same number of positive and negative eigenvalues, right? Because all you are preventing is changing the eigenvalue from plus to minus, right? You don't want them to go by zero, but otherwise you can change any eigenvalue to anything else, okay, as long as you don't go by zero.
But it is infinity by infinity matrix, so I don't know whether this
algorithm. Well, n is so far
finite. Yeah, so
we will take eventually n goes to infinite limit, but only think as a sequence of finite time.
Because the space time dimension is infinite. Xij will be.
Okay. So Xij in this case is not infinite. We have, this is, that's why I said it's a zero dimensional system, right? In actual quantum standard system, we'll come back to that later. Okay? Where there's a band, and band of course has typically infinite number of states. Okay? But we'll come back to that later. Okay, right now this is a toy problem, but then it's a zero dimensional problem. X you really think of a finite dimension. Okay, but eventually at the end of the second lecture, we'll come back to the question what happens in real quantum standard system where actually you are thinking of these as bands, right? And then there are infinite number of states that you have. Okay, and there, I mean, in fact, the whole idea of using this complicated language of K theory, which I'm going to introduce now, is that once you have solved the zero dimensional problem, right, that allows you to just use some case theory result and solve the band problem. Okay, which is an infinite answer. Okay, so you don't really have to do any extra work to solve those more complicated problems, except that you have to know some results in case theory. Okay, so now we come to K theory. And I hope our notion of equivalence is clear, right? Two matrices, X tilde and Y tilde, are equivalent. Okay. If we can find a continuous family of matrices which with eigenvalues plus minus 1 that interpolate between X tilde and Y tilde. So in K theory, we introduce a slightly different notion of equivalence. Again, suppose you have two matrices, X tilde, Y tilde. So we will say that X tilde and Y tilde are equivalent. Okay, so this single symbol will denote equivalence in the K-theoretic sense. If but so what does it say? Okay. What it says is that X tilde and Y tilde are considered equivalent. Okay. See, this means that if X tilde and Y tilde are equivalent to begin with, okay, then obviously if we append any matrix A, okay, you can interpolate between these two without changing this part. Keeping A unchanged, you can just change X tilde to Y tilde, right? So obviously there will be equivalent also in the K-theoretic sense. However, it's possible that even if X tilde and Y tilde cannot be continuously deformed to each other, then once you append a matrix A, it becomes possible to deform one to the other. The intervening path, okay, could involve A in a non-trivial way, okay, and take X tilde A to Y tilde. Okay, in this case, in the particular case that we have been discussing, right, it doesn't happen, but it could happen in a more general context.
And why are you saying that in the case that you had discussed earlier,
yes,
this cannot happen?
Because here I think you can check explicitly that it's already classified by the number of positive and negative eigenvalues. Yeah, number of negative eigenvalues, positive minus negative eigenvalues. And if you append the same matrix A, the number of positive minus negative eigenvalues, if they are equal to begin with, they will remain equal afterwards and vice versa. Right? So here the notion of K-theoretic classification agrees completely with the original notion of double equivalence. Okay, nevertheless, we will see that the K-theoretic classification has some utility. Okay? But you have to do something a little more general. Okay, so this is one step. Okay, extending the notion of equivalence in K-theory. But this still requires that we can only compare matrices which have same damage. Right? X tilde and Y tilde must have the same damage. Right? And if you are adding the same matrix A, then these have to have the same dimension in order to use a trivial definition of equivalence. So if you are given two matrices of different dimensions, okay, there is no notion of whether they are equivalent or not, right? You cannot introduce that concept. Matrices are defined matrices. Okay? And that's what you are going to do now. Okay? We will say that X tilde is equivalent to a matrix X tilde sigma, right? Sigma, right? So sigma z is just all the matrix 1 minus 1.
Dimension of X tilde.
Yes.
So is it telling us about that dimension of that system, that bands?
Well, case, x is the dimension of Eulers, is the dimension of the Hamiltonian. Right? The, how many states, how many case analysis and operators there are. But now you are introducing the notion that even if you have two Hamiltonians, which have different number of case analysis and operators, we can still compare them. Okay? And you can compare them by this new equivalence that I am describing here. Okay? That if you have two vertices, and if one is the same as the other with some sigmas attached to it, okay, 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, they will declare that they are equal. In other words, for given any Hamiltonian of the form xj, right, or x tilde jk, if we add a state of positive eigenvalue and a state of negative eigenvalue, then we say that that's equivalent to dot linear. That's just my definition.
Until now, this mother definition of equivalence.
Yes.
Is equivalent to the previous one.
Yes, that's it.
They are identically equal. That will imply that.
Exactly. Yeah.
Now we want to extend it to the different dimensions of matrices.
Yes, that's it. So this is the more general notion of equivalence. If the matrices happen to have the same dimension, then it reduces back to the original definition.
Yes.
That you are not losing out anything. Right? That if you want to compare two matrices in the original definition, then x tilde and y tilde having the same dimension, then this definition is the same as the original one. And it's that here we are allowing something more. That even if the matrices have different dimensions, we are giving all to compare. So this has some nice property. And one of the main reasons that one wants to do this is that this makes the equivalence class of matrices of this kind into a group. This, the set of equivalence classes, define this way. Okay, I have to give a group composition law, which I am going to give. Okay, but what does it mean by saying that this forms a group? Okay. It means that take two equivalence classes in the K-theoretic sense, right? Which means you are given some matrices, okay, which you can test whether they are equivalent or not by this person. Then I can define an operation which will take two of these equivalence classes and give a hard equivalence class. And that operation will obey the properties that a group hard equivalence class has. Okay? So I have to give you how what operation it is. Okay? Given, say, a matrix X tilde, okay, and a matrix Y tilde in this equivalence class, which may or may not have the same dimension, because now I have allowed different dimensions also. Okay, what is the group composition? And the group composition law actually is very simple. X tilde and Y tilde are given two representative matrices for two equivalence classes. Is by definition X tilde is a bigger matrix. It has eigenvalues plus minus 1. Right? So it makes sense to what equivalence class it belongs to. Okay? And that's the group composition. Okay, this is what is called a K. Yeah, this is always an abelian. Okay, we'll determine the K group for this particular case, Hermitian matrices. Okay, so what is the identity? Identity. Okay, of course, none of these elements are unique in there, right? Because an element is an equivalence class, right? You can pick some representative. Okay, but let's pick some representative. Okay, let's see what is identity. Any guess what matrix will represent identity matrix? The identity has a property that when you compose X with the term matrix, with that group element, you should get back X always. Yes?
The class of matrices that has eigenvalues plus minus sigma.
Yes, so the class of matrices, so basically the identity element is sigma z, sigma z, sigma z. Then why? Suppose you compose X with this. You get back a matrix which is X and then sigma z, sigma z, sigma z, right? But by declaration, they are equivalent. Then it's still the equivalent of this, right? Is this clear?
A has more options than this one, right? This is just an example, right?
Which?
I mean, there you define A to be any matrix with eigenvalues plus minus 1.
These are two different statements, right? These are both ingredients in defining a K theory. This ingredient is telling us that X tilde and Y tilde can be the equivalence of X tilde and Y tilde is extended. Okay? That if X tilde is deformable to Y tilde, we declare that X tilde and Y tilde are equivalent, even though X tilde was may not have been deformable to Y tilde. Okay? So this part, as I already described, that for the particular case that we are discussing, it's not, it doesn't do anything. This allows us to define equivalence between matrices which are defined dimensions.
I mean, why do you take this particular form? I mean, why not just any matrix which has eigenvalues plus minus 1?
Well, you can take, because that's in the same equivalence class. Any matrix which has eigenvalues plus minus, equal number of plus 1 and minus 1 eigenvalues, right? That's literally equivalent to this one, right? So that can be deformed this one.
Yes, but different number of.
Different now, oh yeah. So that is not a good definition of identity matrix. Okay, you could try to do this, do it that way, then you will not, you will run into inconsistencies.
Okay. You will not get this true.
Yeah, because you will see that, we saw that, I mean intuitively you can see, it's the number of positive minus number of negative eigenvalues that is a topological classification, right? So if you append a matrix which has different number of positive and negative eigenvalues, then that is not a trivial topological class. Yeah, you are adding something which is already a non-trivial topological class, so you don't expect them that, you cannot expect that will be a sensible lesson.
Sir, we are increasing dimension by at least 2.
By at least 2. So even in odd dimensions, they are never equivalent. Okay, so if a matrix is of even dimension and another matrix of odd dimension, then you cannot ever have equivalence in this sense, right? So they are considered. So this is the identity element. Okay, now what about the inverse? And then go back to what you want again.
So we can define any of the equivalence which will define some group structure.
Exactly. So you have introduced this new equivalence relation, okay? So that you get a group structure. Okay, and then you can do various manipulations with it. And at the end, we can extract the physical result by restricting to matrices of the set F. So any guess from the inverse of X?
Minus X.
Right? You can, is it simple to compose X with minus X? X compose with minus X is X minus X. Right? It has equal number of plus 1 and minus 1 items. Right? So you can always find a unitary matrix which brings you back to all 1s and all minus 1s. Right? Equal number. That's this one. But not all 1s and all minus 1s. You have to alternate. So 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1. Then you can always go from x minus x to this by unitary transformation, by continuous information.
This group operation, I mean how very physically do I think that I add new energy levels to the system?
You can think of it that way. Then you add new energy levels with plus or minus, equal number of plus and minus energy levels. Right? And that would declare as a trivial operation.
But physically, why should this be trivial?
Well, physically the point is if you think of in terms of bands, right? You are interested, you focus on certain set of bands near the formula. Right? But there are always bands on top and bottom, right? And you can allow some mixing, small mixing of those bands. Right? So the topological classification that we are doing, that it is insensitive to mixing all those bands. It makes it more stable. Right? But as I said, for most purposes, right, the fact that you are allowing this, right, it does make, it makes no difference. It reduces to the original classification problem that we started with. Okay? This is just a convenient intermediate step, okay, which allows you to extract answers in easier way. Right, is adding plus or minus energy levels. You can just think of this as a trick. Okay, so in this case, let me just say what the group is and then I'll end. So basically what we have done is that we have extended the space of matrices, okay, by allowing appending matrices like this. We have extended the space of matrices, okay, by arbitrary dimensional matrices. Right? You are not restricting to matrices of a given dimension. Okay? So the classifying space that we had, that u n divided by u n u k times u n minus k, right? That now basically becomes u n1 plus n2 over u n1 and c u n2. And you basically take the sum over n1 and n2 comes to n1. Okay, because that are arbitrary dimensions. Okay, these are the set of matrices that we have, right? Arbitrary matrices, matrices of arbitrary dimension, right? You can always, if the matrix has a finite dimension, you can always make it big by appending the sequence. Okay, as big as you like. And on this, you impose the equivalence condition, right? It's now, you are no longer looking at continuous paths which cannot deform to each other. Okay, that's of course part of the game. But in this step, right? If there are two matrices of maybe of different dimensions, but their number of positive minus number of negative eigenvalues are the same, they are declared equivalent. Okay? So, as long as n1 minus n2 equal to k is fixed, see, n1 is the number of positive eigenvalue, n2 is the number of negative eigenvalue, matrix is equivalent. So which basically can be translated to the following statement that the topological class are level. Integer k. Where k can run from minus infinity to minus infinity. Okay, k simply reflects the number of positive eigenvalues minus number of negative eigenvalues. And any two matrices which have the same number of same value of k. Which means same number of number of positive eigenvalues minus number of negative eigenvalues is the same. They are equivalent in this sense. Okay? That you can first make the dimensions the same by appending simple sets, and then you can use the usual notion of equivalence that there is a continuous path that connects the matrices. Okay, so the only new ingredient is that if two matrices have different dimensions, you have to append this first to make them into the same dimensional matrix. And then test if they are equivalent by the standard function. Right. Okay, and under that, the topological classes are only labeled by the CPI. Okay. The number of positive points, number of
negative points. So this k I can think as an index.
K you can think as an index, yes. Okay, this is the part, this is the part, topological quantum number. Right? And now we can ask, what happens to k other components? Suppose you have a topological class, level by integer k1, and another topological class, level by integer k2. We compose them by a group composition problem. What is the value of k? What is the value of the topological, what is the integer that we characterize the topological class? Is this question clear? K1 was the number of positive eigenvalues minus number of negative eigenvalues of the original matrix. What are the matrices? K2 is the number of positive eigenvalues minus number of negative eigenvalues of the second matrix. Now you compose the two matrices to find the new topological class. And we are asking for K, which is the number of positive eigenvalues minus number of negative eigenvalues of the composed matrix. So what is K in terms of K1 and K2? Yes?
K1 plus
K2. K1 plus K2, right? So, under composition, of K1 and K2, so this is, what group is this? This is a group of integers under addition. Right? That's a trivial group, right? If you take a sort of all integers, okay, under addition they form a group. Okay? Just add 2 plus 3 and 5, that gives a new element of the group. Okay? And this group then is isomorphic to the group of integers. Okay? So we say that KC 0. Okay, these symbols will explain next time. This is a group of integers under addition. Okay, the C stands for the fact that we are using complex matrices, the partition matrices. Okay, the 0, well, we'll explain in the next step. 0 is basically because we are mapping from point, right? This is a zero dimensional system. Right? We are looking at matrices and not matrices as functions of momentum, for example. Right? In the band, okay, you will get the matrices as functions of momentum. And if you have a band, it's very important to but here, it's just a group of integers under addition. Okay, this is a K group. So this is a K group for this problem.
How would one compose two topological insulators?
Do?
I mean, it's a meaningful question or not?
No, don't think of it as a physical composition. No, it's not. You're not wrong. The fact that it's a group, it makes life easier to actually do manipulations and extract the corresponding case theory classification in a more complicated case. Right? But here, the fact that it's a group basically means that if you're trying to classify topological insulators of this kind, okay, or Hamiltonian gap, Hamiltonians of this kind, they are characterized by a set of integers.
The group property doesn't really matter.
Group property doesn't matter for topological insulators as such, right? But it matters at the intermediate stage. Okay, when you want to use a case theory analysis. The various manipulations are on the case. Okay, you cannot take two physical topological insulators and compose them. I don't think at least a concept exists. Okay, so I think I'll stop here and next time we'll look at more general classes. And at the end, as I said, we'll explain, we'll briefly tell you why this is useful. Right? Because the problem that we have addressed so far is a really trivial problem, right? And we could have gotten this result in the that we're looking at, right? That Hermitian matrices with non-zero eigenvalue, right? What possible topological equivalence can that be? And as long as the number of positive and negative eigenvalues are the same, the two matrices can obviously be formed.